which a scientific test to accept a hypothesis.
Now, there's no one coming.
So students are going to kick us off. We're going to do 20 minutes. You're going to wave a very high-tech sheet with a fine written on it, but I'm sure we'll be able to Stephen's going to look at applying Lego series play to marketing series research.
Thank you. So, first thing I'm going to say is that between jet lag and head cold, this is more base than I've ever actually had in my life. So, the couple of things I want to say to kick off is to disappoint you is that there is no Lego to play with in this session. Aww. That was earlier in the week. However, I do have a couple of the demo version kits that if you do need to fidget with things, they are available. So, the premise, what I'm interested in talking to you about today is this idea of the LEGO Serious Play facilitated methodology being brought to market research. Now, there's a couple of things I will say from the outset is marketers haven't done a huge amount in this area, and it's been really interesting as a marketer coming into Serious Play. My background from Australia, Australian National University, that little town that's the compromise between Sydney and Melbourne, called Canberra. I've run 49 LEGO Serious Play sessions inside the last 12 months. I have number 50 scheduled for next week in Canada, and I'll be honest, I was kind of holding that 50th one to work with my co-author so she gets the anniversary event. The Serious Play sessions basically use a lot of LEGO and a very structured method. It's that structured method that's got me interested in what we can do with this when we bring to market research. Now, the first thing I always love when I go to a room full of academics and I start telling you about LEGO Serious Play, is one of the very early questions I get asked is, do you see an application for this in the industry? Ah, yes, about that. I see an application for it in academia because I'm making it from industry. It's the Serious Play protocol built by the LEGO Corporation. So it's an industry standard that began life in LEGO at the London headquarters in the 90s, back when they were having their big financial crisis and trying very hard to go broke. They put all that effort in and they decided they'd turn it around and go the other direction. Now the great thing is, if you go through the marketing literature, around the late 90s, early 2000s, there's all these little commentary pieces about, oh, it's remarkable, LEGO seems to have turned themselves around. We don't know how. They did this thing with MindSource, that was quite incredible. And I'm sitting here going, hang on, I'm starting to see a parallel here. The marketers haven't picked up Serious Play, they haven't picked up the protocol, they haven't seen that this was the in-house method that turned LEGO around, that they then brought out. Now, our advantage is that they open sourced it in 2010, so we can do anything we feel like, so long as we contribute it back. The other thing I'll point out in terms of the protocol is that it has survived from 96 to 2017, which means it's been through everything ugly that we have been able to produce in the economy. Global financial crisis, 9/11, several presidents, numerous prime ministers, and in my case, for Australia, I've lost count of how many prime ministers we went through. You guys are at least stable over here in the UK. What, 5 or 3 years? We were doing that. We managed to do that too. So Australian efficiency, we turn low. So with this background, so we've got this industry strength method. It does its industrial things. It's absent from the market literature. I know this because my other wife, I'm the webmaster of the Australian New Zealand Marketing Academy. I was looking at the list of the Australian Business Game Council's list of marketing journals, the 1505 list, and I've been through every journal on that list because I needed to find out all the details on it for my website. On the way through, I went, what have you said about LEGO? And the answer is, you've mentioned Serious Play twice in 200-something journals. LEGO itself gets like 110 references, and most of the time people are talking about they're referencing another paper. So I think we've missed something here. Like, we're marketers. How are we ignoring LEGO? So knowing that we don't play with this, no, I'm going to use this technique. But then a real interest for me is, what can I do with it? Now, the first thing is, if you're a quant person in the room, the great thing about qualitative research is it's really good for making quantitative people get very nervous. The great thing about quantitative research is it's really good for making qualitative people go, I think you're doing maths for a reason. Between us, and it is to my permanent amusement that I'm the quant guy in my department presenting the qualitative paper, we can pull up a lot of interesting things. But basically, serious play has this particular framework that it's a philosophy of opinion. The idea that if we bring the right people into the room, we can unlock the knowledge is already present in the room. And for the most part, they've been thinking about this from a strategic point of view. Getting the various people you need to make the strategy decision, get them to use the protocol, and you will unlock the knowledge. The moment I heard this, I'd see they're going, well, this sounds awesome like a focus group opportunity to me. Let's get the right customers into the room and let them unlock what we want to know. Let's get them to start projecting. Instead of having to ask them questionnaires, let's get them to build models and explain things. And this is where I see this platform doing some interesting things, because I also think we can take it out into some of our areas in non-profits, in social change, as well as commercial, because being able to model an idea, model an abstraction in a safe environment might get us a little more truth than we'd otherwise get in face-to-face asking awkward questions. So, there's a philosophy underneath this, the Blair and Willow paper, that their LEGO Serious Plays is in one of seven states in any given environment. For me, the points of interest are, it is a framework which enables participation. If you're at my session on the professional development workshop, going to a room full of academics and saying, by the way, you're going to be talking to each other and sharing ideas. A bit like that point where you started a tutorial and say, and now are there any questions? It was a lot of nerves. And then I said, well, I'd love you to talk about your research that you haven't thought about yet, that you're going to do. And people were able to, because it's a framework that lets participation happen. The other element is that it's a toolkit. It's based on Lego, but it also has that philosophical component of it is modular, and I would say that possibly its biggest weakness is that when someone comes to me and says, can you do X? Yes, probably I can. Can you run a workshop for 225 people? Yeah, probably. Can you pull together get people to work on two conflicting ideas and come together and build a single model at the end? Yes, most likely. And that's where it has. I'm looking to find the limit, so I feel happy that there is a limit. I haven't hit it yet. So it's a toolkit of flexibility, it's a process, it's a method. It also has a little bit of language. Now, I'll briefly explain the protocol. There are two versions. There's the individual, which is what I usually do for my workshops, and there's the group, which is what I do for my research. They're all built on the same premise that you set a task, you allocate a time, you get someone to create a model in response. You then systematically work around the group to get people to explain their model. You take away the first mover advantage. Whatever, either you have a group of people and you say, I'm ready. Does anyone have a suggestion? The fastest reflexes and the loudest voice go first. In this protocol, you take away the ability for someone to jump in fast. There's a period of built-in reflection during the build time, and there's a period of sequence where we go and ask each participant to contribute and the other participants to listen and observe. So we have a reflective element in here. In the group protocol, what we'll do is we move from individual constructions. So in a room like this, I'd ask you to build using the Lego, I'd ask you to share, then I'd say, come together, build a collective answer. Build a collective model that you can each see your own contribution to the component in there. And then that group model is explained by any or all members of the group. Consequence of this is that you start being able to go and track individual contribution, collective ideal, but because all people have to see themselves reflected for it to be a valid build, it also stops dominance. You can't shout someone out of the model. If you shout someone out of the model and you've got 19 or 20 voices in there, the model has failed, you go back and you get sent back to square one. So it does open up a few things. Just briefly, in terms of the hardware, I just want to mention, I literally carried this around the planet. The group focus kit is about 20 kilos, so there's one technical limitation, and that is you need a big backpack. For me, I'm currently carrying 75 of these in the backpack that I will be going to Canada, so I'm used to just lugging this stuff around the place, so the good thing is you get fit. But the downside is you do need a research assistant, or real patients and sorting things. Well, the four things that we have here are basically designed to either pull individual data, individual level data, or group level data. You use them in combination. Now, in terms of picking up a couple of key ideas in here, why I think it works for a number of research tools is that all voices get to be heard. That's one of the things that criticisms of focus groups is the loudest fastest go first. It will also be a weakness, I'm going to say that here and now, that if all voices are heard and you weren't looking for a technique that's going to have everyone contribute, you may not want that. If you're looking to find out what is a dominant theme rather than what is everyone's view. There are a series of protocols in place to make the environment safe. Everyone who creates a model owns the meaning of that model. No one else can overlay an idea onto it. You cannot judge someone else's build. They put the pieces together and they tell you that this represents my, what brings happiness to your day. It's a pile of bricks and said, this is my cat. It doesn't matter if it looks like a cat, once it's been declared, that's the cat. You cannot judge that cat. That in itself was a safety mechanism to allow people to feel vulnerable and to be vulnerable in giving out their ideas and their views. It also brings up one of the limits to address in a moment. And the last thing I'll say on this is that the untapped knowledge, this is the thing I find fascinating every time I run this, is the protocol is designed to get under your skin, inside your head, and get you to reveal more about yourself than you were ready to do. I sort of know how it works. I've done it 50 times, nearly, including my own time. And boy, does it get me every time that someone goes, I didn't expect to say that. You use a different combination of thinking, processing, and you get different information out. You get deeper, you create areas where people are willing to be vulnerable, but it does also mean that you're getting a different set of, a different style of data. Alright, so let's pull into this, actually applying it. The first thing I'm going to say for my theory set here is, the key is, when you make something in Lego and you tell a story about it, it's intentional and deliberate. Even if you don't necessarily have meant to have done this, it is still a deliberate action. All Lego constructions are a result of human agency, so there's no accidental, suddenly a metaphor. You had to make it, you had to produce it. So you do know that the person has contributed this. You are also making objects. These objects can be visually captured, and their stories can be captured alongside them. I'll talk about some of that data in a moment. But the other thing that around this is that whilst you can capture the visual, you can't separate the visual from the meaning the storyteller provides. You can't have a post facto analysis. So, that's all the process, and I'm going to go rapid fire here. You are also bound by one other limit on this process is that you need the first three steps. You can't skip the sequence. You can't dive people straight in and say, yeah, g'day, welcome. Here's a box of Lego. You build me something complicated. Tell me about your childhood in Lego. People's answer to that is no. We've tried it. We've done this. We've thrown people into a room and said, listen, here's some Lego. Build how you see the future of technology using artificial intelligence. Nobody stuck a brick together. Every pile of Lego sat in the center of the room, everyone leaned back from it. When you run through the warm-up, the sequence, the metaphor, the training, you get people engaged, you get their minds ready, and then they can participate. That said, the marketers, so it's market research time. What you can do, quantitative people, if you feel like a bit of experimental design, it does make work here. You can do pre-tests before the warm-up. We were using integrative complexity, and so a storytelling exercise, a visual with instructions, write a story. Write a story about what's going on in this picture. This was our pre-test of creativity. We also had some self-efficacy scales, some competency scales, and also a really good arrogance scale. It's not supposed to be an arrogance scale, but you'll see it. So the pre-test, you can do this before the warm-up. Your first opportunity to collect information is around data form. It's a little rough to do it at that point. You can ask a question, you can also frame. You can have people to start thinking. So if you want to talk about people's attitudes towards luxury sports cars, in the metaphor, it's, what kind of car you'd like to drive? Or the kind of car successful people drive? You can do that in that first phase. So you can, this is the question I ask people at the professional development workshop, what brings happiness? It's really good because that's the one that everyone gets. Suddenly, you see a lot of people's cats and children. And what brings happiness to their day? The dogs need a bit more ground personally, but what you also move against me and making, this is where you first be able to collect some serious heavy end data, essay responses, open-ended questions, and video or storytelling. So this is the one where I've got a little bit of the show and tell. You have the opportunity to do collaborative comparative data, where someone makes a model, they tell the story around their question, or their answer, particularly if you're doing this for a focus group, we've got everyone on a common topic. You get the speakers to explain their model and tell their story, and the other members of that group to observe and see how am I similar, how am I similar, how am I different. You start pulling out data around areas of conflict, areas of commonality. This works well as the second or third stage, when people are used to the idea of writing things down. We also we've done this in real time, our actual study. We had people building models of flexibility, the value of flexibility versus the value of structure, and getting them to document what they heard, what the other team had said, what the other groups had said. Again, comparing and contrasting, pulling that data from individuals, seeing how they saw themselves as aligned or unaligned to the group. Alright, to the process side, alright, this is where the big toolkit comes out. The second phase is where you bring out the, and say about the 20 kilo kit, that's what it looks like on a table. That is 5,000 pieces of Lego, and that is never going to be sorted again in my life. I sorted it twice now. It's designed to never be sorted again. This is the one you merge up. What you can do in these is you can get individuals to explain their way through their documentation. So you're watching their hand, you're able to see where people start pointing to elements, to key parts, to say, this is the video data, so you're using some of your ethnography, some of your qualitative. The key that happens here is that you see this individual model. When you start moving up to a group build, you have the individual models combining together and you can start seeing components, trends and ideas that came through from individuals that cluster together at the next level up. So this is again a way of being able to start sorting, filtering, and getting people to explain. The team video, I want to briefly show you something in this, and just as people become more familiar with the process, they will start illustrating key points. They'll start pointing to elements in the model, and from round one, our friend with the windmill is present here. So people are able to continue their ideas, show their ideas through. The challenge for you as a data wrangler is that this is a lot of video data. So your transcriptions, your coding, your in vivo time. You can also build up to a collective. This is the final model. We've introduced labeling, so we can see where people have contributed ideas. We can have people explain their ideas in. Now I'm going to skip a couple of videos because I do want to show you one thing, which is a question I got asked. The self-location here, this was something we made a real point of, is we wanted to make certain that everyone could see themselves in the model so we could judge a pass-by. And in 15 times of doing this exercise, we had people leave the piece on the side and say, no, I'm not there. It's bare files. Yeah, 12 people in there, 11 models on, 11 figures in, one on the side going, no, not part of this. So it does allow you to track individual contributions and where people felt their contributions. Now, the thing I do want to say, this is a question that I asked on the professional development workshop. I want to bring this up because it's very important to me, is dealing with the data. This is the thing about the arrogance leveler. I wasn't meant to do this, I didn't really expect this, but pulling some real-time data out of the last studies I've done. Our pretest was, compared to I think I'm more creative than the people around me. Well, we ran that scale after people had run the Lego exercise, and boy, did everyone start coming together going, actually, the people around me are as creative as I am. So this was an unexpected finding in terms of what the process does, but it also says that pretest, post-test numbers, quantitative, you can get some interesting things. There is also the confidence. Most people came in, to scale 1 to 7, feeling pretty confident, starting by the end of the workshop, experiencing real confidence as well. So this is something that's, obviously people are pre-selecting themselves to go to a workshop, so they felt they knew what they were doing. So you've got your stats level. On your call side, this is the thing that I got asked in terms of dealing with letters, words and numbers. Linguistic inquiry word count is my favorite toy. I do love this as an analysis platform because what we were able to do on the integrated complexity task is measure the words, the sentence as complexity. Use the 6-letter words as complexity and creativity and use dictionary words. People fatigued. This was, they did the first thing at the start of the session, they did the last thing 3 hours later. They fatigued, they dropped by a word. On average, they were down at a word. So 74 to 73 on average. But what they were doing for those words was more complex, more creative. We were able to use this as a quantitative before we started going in and looking at what was actually said in the stories and making qualitative judgments. We have some capacity to do pretest post-testing. So you've got those elements. Final thing I'm going to... I always pitch my dear beloved Lexi Manser, University of Queensland's finest ontological discovery mechanism. I like this particularly for what we're going to be doing with having people telling their stories around shared common builds to see how these shared common builds, what elements comes forward as the key idea. Also, Lexi Manser just handles huge bulk of text in a variety of interesting ways. I'm still dumb enough to be using 3.5, which requires far too much messing around. Go to version 4. Do not be cheap like I am. So the final thing I'm going to say, limitations. This is the last part of the show because there is a big, giant limit on our platform. What I'm going to tell you, you're going to hate this. There is no data in the bricks. Bricks don't have any residual data. You can't metaforage. The maker owns the meaning. And you can't isolate. And in terms of the data, this is the important one. There are 3 models here. One uses 6 bricks, one uses 4 bricks, one uses 2 bricks. They're all ducks. They are ducks because we say they are ducks. There is no variance. There's nothing you can use. There's nothing you can measure there. Which I know upset a bunch of my qualitative friends when I came in and said, there are bricks. You can count the numbers. You can count the colors. Different exercise? That's not our exercise. So no metaforaging, because I'll just finish on this slide because it's really pretty. You'll note the elephants.
Yeah.
We can talk about the elephants in the room because the elephants didn't mean the same thing on any given exercise. The presence of the elephant, firstly I was always cheering when the elephant got a run. I had a small bet going with my colleagues when I was doing this exercise about the elephant getting a go. 3 out of 4 times the elephant got a go, but the elephant's meaning, in one point they were meaning this was strength, leadership. This was the challenge, unspoken challenges. And this was because we needed someone to put the camp. So post facto, we could not tear this apart and say, oh yes, well yeah, 75% elephant presence means. We can't do that. So that is your limits, that's your weaknesses on that front. I've gone like this early in the morning. Thank you for waiting.
I don't really have questions, this is some thoughts. This is very, very interesting because I had two former colleagues do similar things, managing group conflicts, finding out decision-making models within organizations. And you used to work with MOD and government departments, but yours are much more interesting. What did they do to bring the computers? So when they sit around asking questions, having different data, they analyze data, group together, and come up visually how the decisions are being made and what the conflicts are on them. But you're also much, much more interesting, I think.
The joy of this, one thing I will say is the really big network model here. And we chuck this on 3 hours, and we do this for days. This thing can support a 2-day workshop, that kit. The network diagrams that you can create, it actually is a simulation device. So you can build a scenario and then run simulations in it. So if you're really up for experimental application, you get the participants to build their model, build the wires and connections, and then you say, well, what would the impact be here? Where's the important stuff? You can start pulling experimental elements, pulling out additional data level, and it's manipulative system. It becomes like a programmable system. It's really, I'm going to say, as a facilitator, when you're standing on the outside of it, it's really interesting, but it's also really weird. When someone is holding an elephant and going, listen, the minister's going to want to have action here. Is that the minister you're holding? No, this is the action, it's the elephant. So what the story is.
That was really interesting, by the way, thank you very much. Have you found time when it really hasn't worked? In particular cultures of companies, I can imagine. If you took a firm of actuaries, for example, and said you've got to do that, I can just imagine that no matter how much warm-up you did, it's not going to happen. So have you come across that?
I've had positions with participants. At the moment, obviously, my advantage is I've got a lot of self-selection bias. Freely admit that. I say, doing a Lego thing, people are curious. But I've had participants who have come in, done a whole body language playback, and the mechanisms I don't understand how it works. This is why my mate who's a psychologist is old, going to be on my shoulder for some of these ones. He's overridden that. The systems have broken down as they're seeing the process. What people quite often get frustrated by is they say, oh, I'm going to play the children's toys. Sit down and pitch it to them. You know you're going to be a wrinkle that URL. Also creativity, the other thing about this, the bricolage method. So bricolage is not the term. The bricolage, using found objects, takes away a lot of the creativity challenges. If you have things like sketching tasks or a bunch of marshmallows and, God, I find my marshmallows and spaghetti. That thing shows up, people are like, oh God, I'm not creative. You drop the kit of Lego and they're like, is that? There's always been a piece in there, someone goes, oh, I like that color, I like that texture, I like that. It's thus far between both nostalgia, which is one of its tricks under the hood, play as a different way of approaching. But also when you get in there and you've got some very serious people holding up a duck, very adamantly explaining how 6 bricks are a duck, at that point they're enjoying the process, which is really strange. To them as well, they occasionally come out the other side and go, what happened? Yeah, resistant. The biggest thing is you don't pitch, if you don't have a resistant audience to the technique, you pitch the outcome. Of course, yeah, my advantage of that, the IT guys, so they look at that as well.
The press, it was very interesting to see the presentation. Over the years, I've been to a number of design workshops where people have worked with similarly with sort of paper, card, building things with scissors and whatnot, with the same sort of expectations. Have you compared your technique to paper-based engines building a lot of material?
there has been some work looking at this. I personally haven't gone down that path yet, partly because I'm trying to convince my boss that they want to buy a common paper that they can make here. But what we have seen is that it's a similar process. It's the constructionism. It's this make with your hands, and you're thinking in a different way when you're manipulating objects. It is a similar protocol. The advantage we have is reusability and a lot less people. A lot less people sitting next to other things. This kit is a 20 kilos, it's traveled the world. It has been run various versions of 50 times, all reusable. Like in 50 operations, I've lost two kits.
Do you put the kits together,
or let them put the kits together? They don't have pre-built these. So that.
I'm
going to
use a bit.
Okay, on the kit on the bottom here, these ones you buy in the unit of 100. When you lose one, it becomes spare parts for the rest. These are, there's 250 parts in there. When you lose a few bits from there, you start crying because you're going to have to sort the kits. Mm-hmm. I've been ignoring that for 8 months now. And this one you never sort. You do once, you sort through to unbag everything and find what the parts are. I've also upgraded the hell out of this, out of about 2,000 iron pieces.
So how do you know
you're
trained in it?
I have a great backstory for this, is that I went to Legoland Windsor and was trained in the House of Brick and the Way of Lego as a Danish consultant. So the facilitation was a full certification, full-day workshop. But yes, I said to my boss, can you train in a ship in Melbourne? Something spectacular. And a lot of the way of the brick.
The reason why I ask is because, you know, taking terms, but you compare this to something like absorbent metaphors, where the individual constructs and makes it larger and stuff, but it's all about the explanation. And I take your point about, the element isn't necessarily the element of the room. So the role of the facilitator to understand and interpret and particularly record is absolutely key, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's not the model, it's what we said about the model.
It's the story. This lets people tell stories. Yeah. And tell stories in amazing ways. But what you also get that what I like about this process is that when you bring a group together, they can share their story physically. They can take a piece of their story that's important to them and put it and hand it to someone. When you do full facilitation training, there's a bunch of HR management stuff in there. But I'm a marketer, I'm not touching that with that one. There's a bunch of psychological stuff in there that I am not skilled in dealing with. But I just have got a psychologist as a running mate for this. The key is when it's all the stories you tell. But when you start doing this in a way that you can, one of the group exercises for team development, you build a model of another member of your team and you physically give them those pieces. You hand them a block of Lego that you feel represents them. Symbolism is up past the chart. Alright, final quote. Final question can be done in writing.
Wouldn't it be a great project, and it may be invented already, but it's helpful you out of your dynamic side, if someone could invent a Lego brick sorting device?
Oh, yes.
I mean, is there one invented? Because there is some student group somewhere.
There is one. I will tell you now. The story is, as I'm packing it down, the story of that one is the chap who built it went and tried to buy a few kilos of Lego for a sorting device, had auctioned out and ended up with nearly half a ton of Lego because he won all of the auctions he was bidding on, but wasn't paying attention to just how many. Cheap AI. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.